Howdy do, folks. Welcome to another day out here in Florida on the ranch. This is Frank, your humble guide out here in the Florida Outback Wilderness, or I guess whatever's left of nature. I'm going to be taking you on a little walk today, and we're going to be talking about some cool stuff. I finally remembered to turn on the image stabilizer on the camera, which is a great little feature. It'll eat some battery, but hey, whatever. At least you won't have a dizzying walk as much as usual. I try not to get you too dizzy on this walk. I try to keep you and from getting, you know, passing out, but the shaking can get a little bit much for people, so I try not to do that. But today I'm going to take you on a little adventure around here, and we're going to talk about love bugs, and we're going to talk about, they're all over me. We're going to talk about a couple things we were talking about last night in the podcast about scientific revolution, why it's okay to pave over all the grass that we have, why we're not able to stop the poverty, why we're not able to stop all the crimes, why we're not able to stop any of the problems that we've been fighting for, 100 years? Why haven't they stopped? Why haven't they ceased? Hasn't anybody come up with a better idea? Sure they have. Those ideas don't work. They're not allowed in. That's the problem. They're not allowed to use those ideas because that goes against other plans. There's other plans that stick afoot here, and we're being placated or busied. We're being busied with all the lower end stuff, all the semantics, the individual parts of the bigger picture. You know, so rather than looking at the gas price, let's figure out why we have gas at all. And I don't mean gas and from me eating tacos. I'm talking about fuel. Why are we using fuel? If fuel's hurting the planet, those kind of things we're going to discuss, and that's all part of what scientific revolution's about. And those things don't come around often. Scientific revolutions, not often. They come around every 1,000 years, a few hundred years. Major ones, at least, that upset the whole holly cart, upset the whole system. Right now, they are upheavaling. It's an upheaval of the entire system. From General Clark to whomever, you could find everybody talking about the coup, the great coup that's gone on underway. We are privied in this generation right now to witness a coup. Not too many generations will ever see that. And this is a world coup. This is a coup from business people who have taken over scientific roles, and they've Sovietized the system, meaning that the foundations make the decisions now. So this is what we're going to talk about today. We're going to stop at different places out here. We're going to walk with the herd. So that kind of give us a little parallel as to what we're doing out here in our lives. Usually I wear pants out here, but I'm getting... the love bugs are swarming me, and I always wear pants because I'm going to take you on a little POV of what I'm walking through. You can see the thistle has a little bit of a prickly leaf to it, you know, so it's not the most... Did you hear that? Oh, it's a cow. It's a bull. He's staring right at me. I'm sorry, girls. My bad. My boys or girls. That was a girl. I think a boy. I had no idea that they were right in front of me the whole time. Literally, it's like we were hanging out with the water buffalo for a second there. I wasn't sure. They get pissed off and charge if they wanted to. I'm much smaller than them. Anyway, what we're going to do is we're going to stop at these different areas. We're going to go on some little walks and some adventures. I'm going to show you some of the botanicals that grow around here. All these natural... herbs and plants and things that you can eat. Pepper grass. This stuff is delicious. Tastes just like pepper. So if you want to pepper your eggs out here after chasing some chickens down, you certainly can do that. And so let me get to a couple good spots, and we'll set up and have a conversation today. Thanks for joining me on this walk. Really, first I want to say hello to a bunch of people out there that I know listening. Okay, Sharon, Peter, Dana, Julie, hello, Tammy, Vicky, and thank you folks for buying soap for me. You're keeping me alive, and like I said, I don't want handouts for talking to you. I just, you know, and I'd like, if you want to help support the channel, I sell soap, so that's kind of fun, you know. Hey, I'm doing something clean for the world. Anyway, I'm not turning this into a commercial, but I just wanted to thank you folks for purchasing soap, and I wanted to say hello to a bunch of you. Hello, Mark, hello, Sam. Hello, all of you folks out there. Craig, Heather, there's so many. I feel like I'm on what do you call it, like Romper Room or something. Hello, Peter. Hello, Mark. Hello, Frank. Well, hello, everybody, and welcome to Florida, the last bit of natural nature that I can find without getting thrown off of the property, because these people, this isn't my property. I don't have wealth like this, but this is an appellate court judge that lives here, retired, so I have access to a beautiful farm. They used to own 50,000 acres, and they had their own telegraph station here. So I'm going to take you on a walk. We're going to go have some fun, and I'll see you in a couple minutes. Or to you guys, it'll be a half a second. For me, it'll be a couple minutes. This is neat right here. Here's some milk thistle that's gone completely to seed. As you can see, they float away like a dandelion. And you see that this one has fallen over from its stalk right here. It's just fallen over. And all these seeds right here, all plopping around the grass, just like that. And they're all going to be little thistles. And you see on the field here, these thistle, milk thistles, well, just they're everywhere. There are all these little things that are sticking up. But every once in a while, you come across a little patch of them, and that's because they fell right over. Normally, that the wind would carry these little, you can see, I'm going to pull you back over here. The wind will carry these little seeds all over the field, and that's why they spread so proliferately. That's why they proliferate so well. And so basically, just to show you, that's how ecology works. It's fun. You see how you can walk up to something and know how it happened because you see an example of it somewhere else. And this is what we just do in the field of scientific research, you know, being that I'm just going to show you something that you would do in a day as a scientist. You would find out why, how the plants are growing, and you find out, well, they fall over at a certain point, and that's the reason why there's a spread of certain dimensions. You'll notice that, like right here, for example, see? This one, obviously, somebody fell over, and the seeds just kind of popped up right next to them. And then, so the next little one, just next little milk thistle just pops right up. So you see this succession of the way they domino across the field. And it's just a little side note. I just thought I'd give you a little bit of an adventure. And here, look, there's some dried cow spittle. That's pretty gross, huh? Yeah, that's what happens when the cows they spit and stuff, and they like leave their spittle behind in the grass. It looks like bug, maybe like a cocoon, but it's actually cow icky. See at the spot. You know, as I walk, I'm thinking to myself, you know, the old Hegelian dialectic is what is being used upon us, whereas you're damned if you do and you're damned if you don't. If you want to save the earth today, you might be pushing into Agenda 21, which is actually going to be taking the earth away from people. And according to paradigm science, they could pave over this whole thing. And because they need a scientific revolution, because that needs, it needs for itself to be a revolution to dismantle the old system. A revolution doesn't just come and just add to the science that's already pre-existing. That would be normal science, the science of our grass, the science of our bodies, the science of our stuff that we're accustomed to, that we've already given the test of time. We've already given the test of theorization and scrutinization, right? So we've accomplished that we know grass is what it is, we know trees are what they are, right? That was a paradigm before we knew it was, well, that was a shift, that was a revolution of science. Before we knew what it was, we were calling it something else. So when you're calling, let's say for example, I'm going to give you this example, I use it often, Ptolemy and, what's it called, I know you've heard, some of you have heard me say this before, but Ptolemy and Copernicus, one thought the earth was the center of our solar system, and the other thought the sun was the center of the solar system. Now, for their time, their truths were both accurate and on point for the time, for the tools they had to measure such things. So, but their truths changed under the new scientific revolution, under the new revolution of, no, that's not the center. This is the center of such and such. Whatever the thing be, for example, Einstein as opposed to Newton, you could look at a lot of different things in terms of that. The atom as opposed to, let's say, bicycles, you know, like a gasoline car as opposed to bicycle pedaling. That was a paradigm shift. That was a scientific revolution, putting gasoline into a horse and buggy. Get it? There's no, the horse and buggy now runs on its own. It runs on this liquid or fuel or whatever. So that's the thing. So I'm thinking to myself, you love Mother Earth. You want to help her. You want to give her everything you've got. I literally said, if I croak out here right now, it would be an honor almost, because I give back to the earth what it gave me, this body, this creation. I get to make stuff, get to go do art and talk to you people. You know, the bigger picture, the fact that I'm able to walk out here on earth in the middle of the universe. We're not at the mall. We're in the universe. Okay? Remember that fucking fact. We're not at Chuck E. Cheese. We're on a little blue dot, little tiny, tiny dot in the middle of something so vast we can't get our head around. We can't even get our head around why a light bulb works. We can't get our head around why a TV is so clear and there's no picture inside of it. It's just dots. We can't even imagine those things. You imagine the vastness of the universe. And we have this idea that we should pave over the planet. This one beautiful thing that we have that has all this natural availability of resource. The resources that are on the planet, they're taking apart and they're utilized. They're stealing what they can steal, and then they're covering over the chance that it might grow back so that nobody else can get their hands on it. They're eliminating competition. The business oligarchs are eliminating competition. What's his name? David Keith has a carbon capture company. His motivation is to store CO2 for you to save the carbon, and he's telling you he's going to help the earth from it, right? So he's going to take the CO2 that's trapped from all the chem spraying they do. They put a blanket to trap the CO2 so he can make a fortune off it when it comes time to have it fully roll out, which they're already doing. You can look up right now carbon capture or carbon sink. Depositories or whatever you want to call them, storage facilities. You'll find them if you just type in carbon sink or carbon capture. It's going to be the word on everybody's mouth soon. You're going to hear it everywhere. So the point that I'm trying to make is trees are a competition for Dr. Keith. So he will cut the trees out because the trees are competition soaking up his CO2. So how is he going to remedy that? They have plastic trees. They're boasting this. They don't hide it. They're talking about it all over Harvard. You know, they go to Harvard Commons. That's what they'll be talking about. How are your plastic trees working out today, Doc? But anyway, so we want to save the earth. But then when you do, because of the Hegelian dialectic, they've got you over a barrel. They literally, you're part of an agenda if you're doing green work. Green comes from the old Communist Party thing. That it's an old thing. That's where May Day comes from. That's where the Christmas tree, shape of the Christmas tree basically comes from. A triangular tree on May Day was what was adorned with decorations. And so somebody would wear this costume that had a decorated tree. It was Christmassy kind of thing. And so, you know, our stuff is all mishmash. You get what I'm saying? Look at the fire in the distance. I'm going to show you something just to get off topic here. I want to take you a little POV too. I don't want to make this all about talk, talk, talk. See in the distance, the fire? Or very well could be a cloud making plant, like a geoengineering plant. They've stopped spraying the skies, as you can see, for a couple days. Look how blue that is in the sun. You can actually see the sun is like there's no haze in front of it. But then you see off in the distance something like that going on. Where is it? I'm not sure I could focus on it. I don't know if I have my autofocus on. I'll have to work on it. I'm sorry about that. Let me try to zoom it out. Anyway, you can see right there in the distance, there's like this cloud. And it's forming up into the clouds. It's actually stretching up into the cumulus layer right there. See that? That's about 1,000 feet up, maybe a little bit more. It's going way up into the sky, so it very well could be cloud operation. They have land-based seeding, so there's nothing, no mystery. This isn't, no conspiracy, no theory. Theorizing they did a long time ago during normal science. This stuff with spraying doesn't need, let me make them preface this, doesn't need to be theorized. Get it? Until that becomes normal science. Until that up there, until whatever they're doing that's different than now becomes as normal as your green grass is, that's normal science. Green grass you know about. Before green grass you knew about, it was a god. It was a living, who knows what it was. It was carpet. It wasn't grass to us. We didn't know what grass meant. We know what grass means now. So that's normal science. You could test it all day. This stuff up here, 5G, not tested. They're allowed to do that under the guise of a scientific revolution. They're allowed to put 5G in. Now I say allowed by a human ethic almost. They've convinced themselves, they bought the lie that damaging us is okay because it serves a bigger picture. It serves a better future for us scientifically. We don't need better science right now. What we need to do is stop poisoning children so that we can shut St. Jude's down. Why do we need to have St. Jude's? Why don't we stop poisoning these children instead of continuing these rare diseases? You know where the rare diseases are coming from. Look, we have a large human population. There's going to be a anomaly within this population. There'll be a sickness here and there. All the money that's been spent on all the other crap and all the space race, all the space force, why not spend on those few rare cases that won't cost that much money because they're few and rare? They're not few and rare, though. There's epidemics of these things that they make seem few and rare. Part of whatever idiocy they're doing is causing sickness, okay? And we, as these consumers, we will look past that. Well, it's only a few people. As long as I give my money at a charity, it's okay. Remember, the people at St. Jude's on the board all worked for chemical companies and stuff like that. Some of them are really good people. They're good doctors and stuff. They don't know. I'm talking above the good ones. There are scientists out there that aren't good. I'm not talking movie Hollywood. I'm not talking Dr. No, Dr. Evil. I'm talking human being with real ambition for fame and fortune. A human ambition, maybe that didn't get that much nookie back in school and now wants to be a hotshot star. Because all of a sudden, stardom has come into the science community, hasn't it? Neil deGrasse Tyson and Brian Cox, everybody's a star. Film is a hot, movies, hot medium. Stars, can't touch a star, it's too hot, right? Can't touch a star. Stars are hot, they're distant, far away. They're not within our range. Something to look at, a guide for us, a guiding star. Movies, Hollywood, the staff, Aaron's rod with the snake around it, right? Aaron's rod with the snake. Holly's staff, it's made of holly. Hollywood. See the connection? Don't think that I'm making like just jokes with wordplay. It's real. The secret societies use symbology, correct? They use some symbols and weird pictures. Well, what do you think words are? To a foreign person who doesn't speak English, our language looks like symbols that they don't understand. It looks like, you know, like Chinese does to us, that we don't understand Chinese, right? So take that into consideration when you're involved in your daily activities, that symbols rule our world and they can have much power. They can have a substantial amount of power over people that are superstitious. Most of us are superstitious about something or else. I've lost my superstition because it's taken me time to deprogram superstition. It's been programmed into me. So you got to break this thing. You got to know that 50-50 chance is always. You're going to have 50-50 chance if you walk under a ladder of getting hurt. Even if you didn't walk under the ladder, you still have the 50-50 chance at that moment of getting hurt. Always. Maybe more, maybe less the odds, you know? Anyway, that was just a quick little segment on you're damned if you do and you're damned if you don't. You want to help the earth, you can't, because you feel like you're doing something part of an agenda that's going to help Agenda 21. That's the Hegelian dialectic. It's two opposing argumentative points, ideologies, two points that oppose each other, correct? And that we're holding as the same. We're saying, oh yes, it's okay to stab people in the back and become greedy, greedy producers, make a big million-dollar business, take all the money you can, make extreme profits. Then at the same time, you go to a different class in that same college or the same high school, and they're telling you, oh no, be a good person, be moral, be just. What am I supposed to do? How do I know? How do I go about it? So I become a just and moral, greedy business magnate, right? What is that? That doesn't work. You won't make it in the business. You have to be like Trump to get to where Trump is. And who the hell wants to be that guy? I don't want to be that guy. Unless you're Duck Dynasty. Anyway, see you at the next spot. Just real quick, because I know I'm going to forget to mention it in the next part. These people that are, we think are our servants and elected, they're not elected. They're appointed. You know how hard it was for us to get our jobs? When we went to apply for jobs and they make you do all the questions and sit and It's not like that for those people in the jobs that do the bad things. They're appointed due to specific traits that they show in their behavior. Now imagine, there was probably 1,000 or more seats for, let's say, Dr. David Keith's, a position for his job at Harvard, right? And there was probably 1,000 other scientists with different ideas for a similar thing, like spraying the sky with aluminum particles, right? But they chose Dr. David Keith due to a psychological profile. They knew he would go ahead with certain things, even though that made no sense, because guess what? In paradigm shift, in a scientific revolution, you need a young scientist mind who take orders very well and wants the fame and fortune and doesn't know the results of past experiences. Someone who doesn't know what the future will bring due to, someone who has no hindsight. You need people with no hindsight. It's easy to find them. They're not hard to find. I mean, look at this vast, vast open space, right? And we're talking about a world that has what? A population problem? Where are all the people? Listen, you hear people? You're not even gonna hear a car. We're not overpopulated, folks. Only by region are we overpopulated. Only by local jurisdictions are we populated. We're not overpopulated as a planet. This planet has room for about 10 times more humanity and more animals and all the creatures that ever existed. Do you know that there were, I'm gonna go into the zillions. There were zillions of animals roaming this land at one time. Zillions. And the earth sustained them. And they were larger than us. Now, where is they? Where are they? Nowhere. Here I am, right here. I'm the only animal out here besides the cows that were put here. Post-naturalism, this place is not a real nature. This is a pen. This is someone's backyard. How much room do you really have to walk around on Earth? You can go walk in a public street, can't you? But what'll happen if it's, say, past a certain time of night? You're sure to get pulled over. Don't matter who you are, you'll get pulled over. You'll get stopped by a cop. If you're on a bicycle now, they stop you. They're getting you ready for what's coming. The lack of cars and everybody on these like new bicycles. Even if they have motors, it doesn't matter. There'll be like little bicycles that are solar battery charged or whatever. But that's not it. That's not what I'm talking about right now. I'm talking about the fact that these people aren't appointed. They're appointed. They're not elected. So nothing you elect is going to help a situation. We can't stand up and say, hey, we'll elect a different leader next time. That's not the case. That doesn't happen. We don't ever elect anybody. They're appointed. We go flip a lever. Flipping that lever puts in our head, I will accept the lesser of evils. So anything that befalls you, it's your own fault. Our own fault. We chose a lesser evil. So we have to expect evil is part of lesser. It doesn't matter the degree of the less. It's less. Okay? It's less. It's that simple. It's less. So when you're talking about the lesser of evils, you still chose evil. And you can't deny it. You could work. We can lie our way out of it, but we're all lying to ourselves because the truth is in the vocabulary. The lesser of two evils. And, of course, the lesser of four evils. It doesn't matter. They have already planned out what the future will be. If you think that a policy person in a government, if you're going to choose a different leader, do you think with the infrastructure financial crisis we're going to have already with the leader, do you think electing a new leader, uplifting the entire infrastructure to repair it and do major changes, you think that's going to be cost effective? They would never allow that to happen. They would never allow a different type of leader in the office to bring down what's already there. And what's already there was just to get everybody on board to build the automated world, all the factories with robots, so that we're obsolete. We're obsolete now. Robots. Use the McClellan Tetrad. Put robot. Put, you know, automation as the medium. And see what it obsolesces. It obsolesces us. And maybe a few people to fix the robots, but those can be fixed by robots. And you feed Grammarly. Grammarly's artificial intelligence. They're going to be using that for the great think. The great think is like the Internet of Things needs a brain. Grammarly will be it. Part of the brain. Maybe the emotional human side, that writer side. The writers write things that are emotional. See you at the next spot. Oh, by the way, don't use Grammarly. Here, let's walk a little. Show you the footsteps. I don't know if I have an image stabilizer on, so I'm going to walk real slow. It's very dry out here, and you can see there's no spray. So the skies are fairly clear. That means there's no humidity being trapped. Isn't that a beautiful thing? There.
Isn't that beautiful?
Am I recording? I can't see the screen. It's so hard to see with the sunlight in my eyes. There's a rabbit hole right here. Here, let me back it out and let's go down the hole. Ready? We'll see what's in there. Hello? Anyone home? Anyone home? No, nobody's there. I want to show you something else. This is going to blow your mind a little. Let me put on the, here so you don't get shaken around. Image stabilizer. And here, watch this. Can you see any? You see how desolate it is out here? You wouldn't see any water, would you? I don't see any water anywhere. There's probably no water anywhere on this place. You can see it's really dry, so digging into the ground, I probably wouldn't be able to yield too much. I do a lot of work to be digging for water here. It'd be very hard to find water on this prairie. But something tells me I got an itch that's telling me, just keep walking. Maybe you're going to find some water soon. I'm really getting thirsty. And of course, we're out here in the middle of nowhere, and you have nobody. You can't call grocery guy to deliver. You can't call anybody. You can't call Domino's, you know what I'm saying? So you really have to make do with what you find, okay? We might be getting lucky right here. Is this water? Let me see. We got to look over the edge here. No, it's dry as a bone. A ravine is dry. What about over here? This looks like a well-worn path right here. Maybe if we follow this path, we could get somewhere. You see how well-worn that is? I get nervous when I hear planes in the distance and helicopters. I don't like it. Anyway, so let's just keep following this and see where it takes us. We're gonna keep following this little path here. I'm really starting to run out of steam. If I don't find water soon, I'll be in trouble. Of course, you want to filter any water you find out here. But we're going to follow this path and see where it leads us. Game paths are usually a good way to find yourself either out of a forest or to water. Well, what do you know? Look at that. If I was down a couple feet right here, nothing. Come up a little bit and look what you find. First, we got to watch out for alligators and snakes because this is where stuff would come and the snakes would be waiting to ambush. And something big over there just popped up or jumped in the water. Could be a turtle, nothing major. But you gotta watch out for alligators. But here's your water. In the middle of all of this, if I put my hand up high, you can see it's a little bit higher than where I'm standing. You wouldn't see it through all these thistles over here. They're just kind of like a forest of camouflaging the landscape. Right here we have what looks like an alligator slide or something. I'm looking for alligator prints. I don't see them. Usually they get rid of the alligators that are here because they will eat the cows. But there are fish in here. There's plecos. There's plenty to eat. If you need to eat something, you can go fishing here and you could catch one of these turtles or plecos and actually have a meal. So you wouldn't die out here. You wouldn't have to go hunt down a cow. Probably wouldn't be the easiest thing with a stick or a rock. You probably, you know, if you don't have a firearms, how are you going to eat hamburger? You could spear a fish, it's a lot easier. You could trap them or you could net them or do whatever you have to. But you can see there's plenty of fish in there. On the surface, you can see them. Listen how quiet it is out here. There's a plane in the distance, that's it. I think there's a tractor off in the distance too. Oh, baby alligator. There you go, baby alligators. That's what those are. Here. See the baby? I can't see, my screen's too dark. There's a baby sticking his head up right there. I hope I capture him. I'm not sure. I should have got him. He should be in the frame. He just went down. But those were baby alligators. So Mama's gonna be around here somewhere. And I think I'm gonna probably wanna vamoose. I bet she's laying down on the bottom. And I don't wanna get too close to this edge, because if she springs out and she's pretty big, and you know what happens to me, I become Din Din. We'll try to find some tracks on the bank here. Yeah, I don't want to get too low. The good thing about alligators is if you stand tall on the bank, they're not probably going to attack you. But if you're low on the bank, like a dog or something, height, they're going to come after you. All right, just wanted to show you that in the middle of all this. You would have never seen that down there. Just kind of, you know, waiting for you to jump in. But I wouldn't jump in there willy-nilly, because the alligator will make a quick meal of us. You could check this out. It's pretty interesting. Yep. Ah, alas, I knew him well. Ba-dum-bump. Hamlet. Anyway, let's check out the teeth. How interesting that is, huh? Look how big that eye socket is. A very visually acute animal. A very big ocular space there. See all that space for the ocular nerve? There's a lot of eye activity on this animal. They're very good at vision. You can see the sense of smell is advanced as well. The size of the pits there, that where the nerves run and the taste buds all connect, massive, massive. And an animal like this, that mainly eats grass, but has to be wary of predators. Oh wow, the teeth are just coming right out. Look at that. I don't want to disrespect it. Put it back the way it was. Rest well, buddy. Thank you for letting us look. Anyway, here's more of his parts. It's like a shoulder blade, it's another part of his jaw, lower jaw. And some more stuff over here. It's older, it's bleached. You can see it's been out here for a while. I remember, I think in the beginning of the year when it was decomposing, it was fairly toxic. The smell is pretty strong of decomposing animal. You know that if you've ever had something die in your wall or something. Anyway, you can see I'm in the middle of nowhere, middle of somewhere, but not really. You're on your own out here, which is nice. I like that, and it makes me more aware of myself, more aware of my frailties, more aware of what danger could befall me. And I'll give you a prime example. This is a fun story. We were camping out here, and I'll give you one of the many stories. I've had a lot of panther encounters, and one in particular, it was 3 o'clock in the morning. I had gotten up to get out of the tent to go over and visit nature. Nature was calling, and so I'm standing out there outside the tent, just kind of looking off into the distance, 3 in the morning, half asleep. Fire had just gone out. It was very dark. Sure enough, I hear the sound of snoring and purring at the same time. It was a snore purr. And if you have a cat, you know that sound the cats make when they snore and purr at the same time. Very cute. Well, ironically, the panther, the jaguar, that mountain lion, it's all the same cat, just a little bit, the little delineations a little differently for each nation or wherever they come from, because of geographical conditions being different. They have formed a different type of body structure or color, something like that. Just minor differences in each of that cat, but it's the same type. It's basically all mountain lion, it's all panther, you know, they're all jaguar, they're all the same. So what it is that's the biggest cat that purrs. So I'm thinking to myself, like, okay, this could be a little kitty. And then you hear the deepest growl that I can't even get that deep. It was so deep. If you listen, if you like type in panther growl, you'll hear the gurgle. It's like a lion's roar. It's the deepest sound ever. Love bugs everywhere. It's the deepest sound ever. And sure enough, 3 a.m, me and it just met out there in the wild of the night. It was sleeping next to us in the tent. Like, comfortable. Not trying to eat us, just wanted to be with us. It was a unique experience. Of course, this is what I don't like. In a direct line with me, that I don't like. if I disappear right now, it'll be you'll know why. Get out of here. Piss me off. Get out of here, you're ruining my environment. Seriously, like I don't really need airplanes flying over my head like that. I don't really like that too much. Not for nothing, but you know what's really creepy out here? It's you're all alone and like literally anything could happen. But sometimes, you know, I'll get a flashback. I hear like a mosquito whiz by and it sounds just like a round. And I get like a chill up my spine. I'm like, wait, I'm waiting for the pain to come. But no, it's luckily nobody's accidentally hunted me out here. Thankfully. That's why I don't give out my location. I don't want people to know where I'm at. But anyway, so I love nature. I'm not into this post-natural world. We're gonna get up to these trees and we'll talk more about this post-natural nonsense. Why it's okay to pave over all of our grass. Yep, you'll find this interesting. Hey folks, look at the hawk feather. Isn't that beautiful? That's a wing feather, you know? See one side short, one side long? This is the leading edge of the wing, right there. And that's the tail, the wider part. That's what gives it its lift. Isn't that pretty? Make a nice little pen out of that. Anyway, what I'm trying to make clear is that the tree doesn't matter to the people who are doing the thing now. Don't matter. These people have been convinced, and that's why they're hired for their jobs, because they're good at being convinced at stuff. And they're convinced that the science that they're going to be using to change the system, oh, let's put it this way, even if they're not convinced that it will do anything, they don't care because their motives were different. They were maybe a scientist, but it doesn't mean they're an outdoors person. You get what I'm saying? This could be the kid that was locked in the basement, you know, with dad's Playboys. I'm saying, you know, we were all there at one time, but some kids stayed there till they were like too old, you know, that weirdo. The guy that you were always worried about on the internet, the one that was going to hack you. Yeah, those are the folks that are doing this. You should have worried about them hacking you because they're hacking at the world now. And they're doing it under what Thomas Kuhn, a professor for Oxford, explained as the scientific revolution. Meaning, the difference between giving you an aspirin or drilling your head, you would choose what? Aspirin. You would rather have, or for a headache, you would rather have the aspirin than have the head drilled with a drill bit. Yes, obviously. That was a good scientific revolution. They're using that guise. And they, I mean, business people that have gotten a little science degree, no big deal, who cares? What? So what? Anybody can get a science degree. I got one. What's the big deal? It doesn't take much. It takes studying. It takes learning. Anybody can do that. You can do that. We all can. So these people get up there. They do their thing. This is the thing. Where most of us are made to think that we can't do it. You can't do that. You're not smart enough, right? They told you that. Or they made you feel that. They made you feel that in school. When you were young and you couldn't memorize numbers and places, they made you feel like an idiot, right? And you say to yourself, I don't want to learn. I don't want to feel like an idiot anymore. I understand. They made me feel that way. Until I made them look a little stupid when I showed them that I'm not an idiot and what they were doing was indoctrinating me into BS, trying to confuse me and fill my brain full of factual nonsense, I mean, data nonsense, data sets of numbers that don't mean anything. Sure, this happened at this time, but why did this happen? Why? You know, you heard of the Balfour proclamation, the Balfour Declaration, whatever it is, from that gave Israel to the Rothschilds, right? You've heard about it. You never learned about it. They told us the date. You don't know the date. Big deal. They don't want you asking questions. And then eugenics, the genetics thing that's going on, the genetic modifications, happening to humans too. They're getting more people to get married or have babies that will be more genetically inclined to take orders, to be social people, not to be the questioner. Yeah, they do that. They could do that. You know how you could do that? The same way I did it with fish. To find the best species to replace back in the ocean. When I was a marine biologist, I used to raise snook and fish like that, and the different snap or whatever, and to raise them to that so that we have a better genetic to send back to the sea, which was depleted of these creatures, so that the stronger ones would be put back, so that they would be able to withstand the ridiculous onslaught of industry. Now, why has an industry been cured and quelled? Because they want the environment to crash. That's part of paradigms shifting. If there's no reason for a new science, there's no reason to employ any new science. There's only reason to study what we have already. The natural science of the tree will continue learning, right? Until we're faced with an anomaly. Once the anomaly comes, then a crisis comes. You dig? So these things like dominoes fall. And you see it happening in your society. The anomaly was what? Global warming, global cooling, global blah, blah, blah. Everything. The globe does things. It warms, it cools. Our memories go about from here to lunch. We think in scales of, like, what am I doing later this afternoon? Or, at the most, what am I doing later this month or this week? At the most. The people that are planning this bigger show think in 100-year, 1,000-year, million-year terms. Different world than us. They have separated the species. It is a separation. We're a different branch of humanity, literally the proles down below. That's only a political name. If we educate ourselves more than they have, how could they constantly rule us? The trick is not stopping them. The trick is stopping us. We have to stop ourselves from making the same mistakes and not learning from history. We do not learn from history well. At all. Or we don't give a rat's ass. That's due to demoralization. We've been so demoralized throughout our culture. You have a dream, you want to be an American dream, you want a peace, and then you failed, or somebody in your family failed, and it was hard on you, and you felt bad. It ruined your life. You had a breakup because of money, financial, your wife's left you. Life's over now, isn't it? It's ruined this and that. Some of you are happy, but life is over because of such and such a thing. Because of financial reasons, not because of you. Your true nature didn't chase away your lover. Your true nature wanted to love them. You weren't allowed to because there's constraints. There's constraints by society that are specific. And they know the predicted outcomes of these constraints. If I put a ball and chain on your ankle, I know that you're only going to be able to run 2 miles an hour. I can track you down even if I'm a lazy bastard. Get it? It's very easy to constrain people when you have a little bit more education than them. And I'm not meaning that they're smarter. They just have more of the knowing thing. They know the thing. They know that the tree's made of stomata, bark, all kinds of different parts, right? The majority of us couldn't care what the tree's made of, right? Until we lose all the trees. And we're like, oh, what was that we needed to maintain in the tree to keep it alive? They're getting rid of trees, folks, and the reason being is it's competition for businessmen. These aren't scientists who care. These are scientists under the front of, these are businessmen under the front of science. Or they're paying 9 out of 10 scientists, so-called, young people usually, to make the decisions through their personal approval, not from testing. Not from testing, it's approval. Oh, 9 out of 10 scientists say they like it. That doesn't mean they tested it. And where's the 10th one? He's at the bottom of the lake with concrete shoes. They got rid of him quick, or her, or whomever. And they'll get rid of the other ones once their job is over. I got a spider going up to my hat. It's really tiny. He just kind of, I'm going to let him crawl on me. Sorry, little buddy. Go find a different place. I don't want to hurt you. I'll smush him later. I don't want to smush him. Poor little guy just cruising around. He thinks I'm like part of the tree. See, his paradigm shift. His world was just shifted when I shook him off because a tree wouldn't shake him off. I'm not a tree. I changed his truths. He thought he saw me here. The thing about the truths that can be changed, we don't have universal truths in a grand scale other than what we share. Me and you can share this conversation. We know we're sharing it. Universal truth covered. That's a truth, okay? We're doing this right now. There's a tree behind me. Truth. Universal. You see it. We see a sunset together. Truth. Universal truth. We saw it together. That's about it. All the other stuff is fluid. And then they proclaim this, that it's important to have that because you wouldn't be able to change science for the better if you didn't have a complete upheaval. So they're using that excuse right now, and they're creating crisis on purpose through all the different things, letting things flood, letting things break, letting things go fall apart, so that the crisis will create itself locally without too much help. And then all of a sudden, you and I are blamed for it. And then we got to give up all our stuff and all our grasslands because you wasted it. You squandered it. No, we didn't. You see what I'm saying? You getting my drift? All right, I'll see you at the next tree. See, as I walk this side right here, I've got to be really, really careful because rattlesnakes live in there and boars. And boars get scared. They just charge and they come. They come at you fast. Trying to see if I can find a rattler for you or a big snake, you know, something interesting on the walk, more than just bushes. You know what I'm saying? So I figured I'd walk up on this edge here. There is stuff moving in there, you hear it? It was just moving. See, this is a game trail. That's not from a motorcycle, that's from the cows. They literally make like a motor, like a tire track. Isn't that amazing how clean that is? It's literally a tire track. But they see, there's no two of them. There should be two if there was a car. And they don't ride motorcycles here. But the cows will go back here, but boars will be back there too. It's fun to see wild boars out here. They're really kind of cool. These palmettos are actually edible. What you do is, I'm not going to do it because I don't want to get in this bush. But if you get into the nook of this, and you just got to step on these to press them down, you don't even need a knife. And what you do is you pull the center chute, there'll be a center one in there, the hearts of palm. Just like you get at a Chinese restaurant or a very expensive salad, you get a hearts of palm salad, right out of there, palmetto bushes. They don't cost anything. You spend a fortune on a hearts of palm salad, and look how much of it that just naturally and wild growing. And you pay how much for a heart of palm salad? Right? Isn't that crazy? Bamboo shoots? How much do we pay for a can? I mean, a can of bamboo shoots are like $1, right? But if you go to like a restaurant in some exclusive place, like, this is made with bamboo, you know, oh boy, it's grass, big deal. Bamboo grows like crazy. It's not rare. Anyway, there's lots of, I'm looking for a botanical specifically that I use for my soaps, which is called Beauty Berry. And I'm finding stuff that's not Beauty Berry in here, and I'm trying to locate Beauty Berry because it's a bug repellent. And it's also edible. I mean, it's delicious. That's exaggerative. It's good. I like it. I personally find it delicious. I love the berries. This right here is peppergrass. Right here, this is Lycopodium, they call it. Lycopodium is the Latin name. Peppergrass. It's delicious. Another good one. It's got vitamin A, vitamin C. They're studying it for its health properties. They call it a weed. But if you don't have pepper bush out here, you better have yourself some peppergrass, because then you can make yourself a salad. Literally, you can season your foods. There's other stuff out here that I can't touch, like wild parsnip. Right there's wild parsnip. And you gotta be careful of that stuff. It's poisonous, and it also it'll kill you. I mean, it'll kill you, and like, you know, it'll cause you like a reaction like poison ivy. And you can see there's some nice shrub, brush here, and a shrub, some brush. So now there is still some stuff out here. The rest is all grass. You know what I mean? It's literally grasslands, and they do that for the cows, of course. It's got to be that way. But you see how trees are not as important as you would imagine they are. And I'll give you another thing that's happening in Florida is they're building up Florida. Florida's supposed to be a super city for the UN 21 Sustainability Project. And so Florida, because it's the... whatever the hell that was. Florida is a peninsula, and it's very easily manageable from all sides. And the good thing is that you're not going to be close enough, and I won't be close enough to the water if we live here. We'll be inland in these little city, smart city type things. The thing that they're doing is they're doing a lot of building here right now. They're increasing the building tenfold. I've never seen so much building going on in one time, and nobody's really moving into the homes. They just sit there. But what it is now they're going to build so much that the property value will drop on everybody's home. Even the biggest homes here, the property values will drop because there's going to be so much availability to move that people will stop wanting to move here eventually. It'll be so packed here. And they're doing it. It's incentive. They've got to give an incentive to get people down here. And they got to create bad weather up north so you come down here during global warming. It's freezing in your town. It's cold, huh? Global warming, huh? Global warming's localized. They do local warming. Okay, I've studied it here. I got a spider on my glasses. When I used to study marine biology here, sorry, do this. I used to study snook, and I would also fish for snook, and I also fish for my dinner. So when your dinner starts becoming harder and harder to maintain, you start wondering why. And so what happens is the waterways in the back bays heat up very fast right now. And it's because of all the tree cutting, mostly, because what happens is a lot of the debris falls in. It's called tannic acid. Tannic acid darkens water. Tannic acid is how they used to tan hides. They used to use the river water. They would put the hide in the river water, and it would tan. They'd tan a hide. And it's because tannic acid has preservative properties in it. Okay, tannic acid, tannins are used in wine making. Tannic acid, you've heard it everywhere. You've seen it everywhere. You can make tannic acid from grapes. You can do it from a lot of things. Anyway, point I'm trying to make is that there's something really big in there. Really big, and I don't know if it's a cow or not. Yeah. Ready? Come on, let's see what this is. Step back a little bit. Oh, charge me. It's back there. It could be a deer or a boar. I don't know what. I don't think it's a cow because there's no other cows around. They don't usually separate like that. They're herd animals. Huh. Anyway, so that was exciting. I don't know. Sometimes there's some stuff back there. You just gotta be sure. I don't want to get run over by something bigger than me. Well, anyway, folks, I just want to thank you for walking with me. This has been a really nice walk, and I think we covered a few things that are kind of important. I do these talks a lot, so I really, it helps when I have somebody to communicate to rather than just to speak to the microphone when I have a thought in my head, which is what I kind of do, because out here I could do some good thinking. You're clear of all the Wi-Fi signals, you're clear of all anything that would interrupt with your brain. No television, no radios, no barely any kind of motor sounds, once in a while a plane or something. And the only technology is this camera. I have my phone in my bag, but my phone's a dumb phone. I don't even have a smartphone. So there's no Wi-Fi coming off of me. I'm emitting no signal that can be traced, which is nice, too. anyway, I just wanted to let you know that within the scope of all that's going on, there are people out here that know what's happening, and they're in the science community. They know what is going on. They know this is happening, and they can't do anything about it. They want to. Believe me, they want to. Did I just find the puffball mecca? I sure enough did. Puffball mecca, baby. Look at that. Look at that sucker. Oh, puffballs are so good. I'm gonna put this in my bag. I'm gonna take a whole bunch of these home with me. Wow, here we go. Puffball, let me see. That one's really, you see, it's like kind of brown inside. You don't want to eat that one. Only if they're white inside do you eat them. They have to be fully white puffballs. Once, if they're brown, they're not edible. Yeah, that, see, they're, these are too old. I wouldn't even, so I'm gonna actually leave this one. I'm gonna leave this one, but I'm gonna break it apart. I'm gonna break it apart. Oh, see, it's brown anyway. Oh, pew. Yeah, you don't want to eat that one. You get rid of that. Anyway, that's puffballs. Usually, they're if they're all white, they're totally edible. So that's a nice find to find out here. They're a good thing about puffballs is they're filled with water, and they filter the water as they eat it. They ingest it. They pull it in. They filter it, so it's clean. So if you're needing water and you don't have a filter, a puffball mushroom that's an edible one will suffice, and it'll get you some water. Pretty cool, huh? All right, let's walk over here. Walk over here. Get excited when I see puffballs. Sometimes they're as big as a basketball. They're so delicious. It's like, you know, they kind of have a chicken consistency. Texture-wise, you know, not flavor. But anyway, so I'm gonna shut the camera right here because I have to get back to where I have to go right now, and I will get back with you at the next spot, and I'm gonna close out this talk, and I'm just gonna leave you with a few bits of advice or input or whatever you want to call it on how to handle this train coming at us, because we're on a track. Every once in a while we get on the tracks, and you just got to be aware that you're on a track and you have to get off it, because otherwise it will capture you and take you right away. It will. It's made to. If you allow yourself to be hypnotized for 1 second, then you're gone. I'll be right back. Want to see something really cute? Where is he? Oh, he went behind his mom. Hold on. See mom and baby? See? That's how they work, just like humans. No different. Actually, they're a lot nicer, aren't they? They don't eat us. Little babies. All right, girls, I'm leaving. Don't worry. Don't get upset. I had to come out of the wind. And just to say one last thing, thank you. Just thank you. That's the last thing I just want to say to you, is thank you. I appreciate you guys, folks, everybody, being part of my minuscule life, my world out here. You're a part of it, you know, and I appreciate that. Whether or not you can hate me, love me, doesn't matter. What I'm saying to you is not opinionated. It's not coming from my belief system. It's coming from my research. This is what you call dissertation. I'm actually giving you the what ifs, the as, and the how fors of how this is happening. I can't do it all in an hour, so I try to give you a broader tip of the iceberg picture. If you have any questions on any of the things I talk about, please ask me. I will broaden the conversation on it. But as it stands, I don't have enough time in an hour, and I only have an hour because I know that anything more is just fruitless. No sense in putting it. Because, you know, even on TV, we're used to 1 hour shows. Movies, it's hard. Now they're down to an hour and a half. Movies used to be 2.5 hours. Now they're an hour and a half. So you see, it's very hard to condense knowledge and time spans that are too short, which is why they do that in courts. which is why they don't let you have enough time to explain, because they don't want you getting a message. Mao Zedong said, I'm not afraid of armies. I'm afraid of one person with a good idea, and he's able to communicate the idea. That's the fear Mao had. Mao, very powerful man, but still, that's the fear. One person with a communicative idea, forget it. Life's over for him, as his game would be ended. As it stands, folks, I will bid you adieu, and I will see you tonight on the podcast later on this evening. I'm not sure exactly what time, but we'll talk about some new stuff that's going on in the world. Thanks for joining me. This is Frank from Outside the Box on the ranch in Florida, wishing you health and some happiness in this crazy paradigm shift and this crazy scientific revolution that we're in. Last thing, reading Kuhn, K-U-H-N, Thomas Kuhn, Structure of Scientific Revolutions. It'll help. There's plenty of YouTube videos with audio on there as well. Peace and be well, folks. Be safe and happy. Thanks. Love you guys.